Rain, rain, more rain. The remnants of Tropical Storm Bill are dumping water on parts of Texas that were devastated by Memorial Day flooding.
Bill's winds have weakened, but as George Thomas reports, the storm's impact will continue for days as residents in several states brace for flash flooding.
We saw very strong winds on the north of the east side of this thing. A lot of rain.
With the storm downgraded to a tropical depression, Texans have to deal with not just the aftermath of Bill.
Another day in paradise.
Like cleaning these flooded condos in Seabrook, Texas.
Went to work, came home, this happened.
But now have more rains, flooding, and potential tornadoes to deal with.
Hoping it'll not get higher, because it is going up in our staircase and our balcony.
Tropical Storm Bill made landfall about 90 miles southwest of Houston on Tuesday, with maximum sustained winds of 60 miles per hour. Forecasters say portions of Texas could see 3 to 6 inches of rain through Wednesday, with some isolated areas getting up to 12 inches.
All that rain, by the way, is bad news for a state that is recovering from 2 months of historic rains and flooding.
Just ask Frank Prochaska.
We thought we were out of the woods, and now this tropical depression is coming up.
A couple of weeks ago, storms caused water to swell up from a nearby lake, washing out his front lawn and draining into his home. Now rains from Bill are threatening to do the same again. May has been the wettest month ever in the state's history. All that rain means many lakes and reservoirs are close to capacity and flood-prone areas still saturated. Storms over the Memorial Day weekend brought widespread flooding to Texas and Oklahoma, killing more than 30 people. In Prochaska's community, water management officials are worrying about just how bad another wave of wet weather could get.
We have three different reservoirs that are on the West Fork of the Trinity River, Lake Bridgeport, Eagle Mountain, and Lake Worth. And part of our job is to make sure that we pass the water through all of them and minimize any damage.
CBN's Operation Blessing was on the ground helping victims of the last flooding in Texas. Well, teams are back in the region again, preparing to work with local pastors to help residents and assist with cleanup. Meanwhile, Bill is expected to weaken as it moves through Texas and into Oklahoma over the next couple of days. George Thomas, CBN News.
Thanks, George. Well, you know, the government isn't very careful with the records it holds, and it holds vast quantities of records. Well, a hacker got into one of them, and it's a long-term impact that's worse than 9/11. That's what some people are saying about the cyber theft of private information from every single federal employee. John Jessup has more on that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
That's right, Pat. New revelations about the impact of that cyber attack on federal employee records. A report says it has ripped a gaping hole in U.S. espionage defenses.
Devastating cyber attack in our nation's history.
As one who represents the city that was attacked by 9/11, I consider this a far more serious one to the national security.
Were the Social Security numbers, were they encrypted? Yes or no?
No, they were not encrypted.
There you go. There you go. Now we're getting somewhere.
The stolen information can help foreign intelligence agencies track U.S. employees with special skills or diverse backgrounds. The information can also be used as leverage against federal workers who have relatives and friends who live overseas.
This could provide essentially a roadmap to a nation state or a potential terrorist to target and identify those individuals that work for the federal government to gain access to other sensitive environments and data that they're going after.
The hackers are believed to have stolen the information of some 4 million former and current federal employees and contractors. A massive Obamacare database is raising security and privacy concerns. The data warehouse is called Mideast. The government plans to use it to keep the personal information of millions of healthcare subscribers indefinitely. Security experts warn retaining data longer than necessary raises the risk of hacking. The Obama administration says Mideast is secure and is essential to the smooth operation of the healthcare law's insurance markets. But the administration, Pat, launched Mideast without a complete privacy assessment.
They're all fouled up, ladies and gentlemen. Our government doesn't work. None of the agencies work properly. And we have continuous, just a drip, 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 drip of these failures. And this is one more. Now they've got this giant data warehouse on people who've signed up for Obamacare, and it's being held indefinitely. And experts say, well, look, 2 or 3 years is all you need to store. After that, these things should be erased. You don't want some history of what your doctor's visit was 20 years ago. It's nobody's business. But if somebody hacks into it, they can destroy your life. And we don't like that. Hey, there's something else happening in the world today that kind of catches us all by surprise. The border of Israel with Syria, I've been there, right at the edge of, you know, Qunetra and that area, in the Golan Heights. But now ISIS is moving down, and you see where that Druze area is between Syria and Jordan and Israel. Now ISIS is threatening genocide against the Druze. Here's John to tell us about it.
That's right, Pat. The Israeli Defense Forces is ramping up its presence on the northern border after significant movement in Syria by ISIS and other Islamic extremists. It is a result of Syrian President Assad pulling his troops back towards Damascus, the Syrian capital. As Chris Mitchell reports, these changes pose direct threats to Israel and one of the region's largest ethnic groups.
Here on the Golan Heights, the IDF is preparing for the threat that thousands of Syrian Druze might come pouring across their border. The Druze people are one of the many ethnic minorities spread throughout Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, and Israel. This Druze demonstration is one more sign of a growing crisis on Israel's northern border. They're calling on Syrian President Assad to protect thousands of their fellow Druze left vulnerable after his troops left the area. They're now exposed to ISIS and a potential genocide.
This is a place called the Shouting Hill. I'm standing in Israel, and just a few feet away is the Syrian border. Druze families were separated by the 1967 Six-Day War, and they would come here and literally shout at each other before the age of the internet. Now the Druze are shouting to the world that their families inside Syria are in danger and that ISIS is right across the border.
We're close to the to ISIS, as I told you, 4 kilometers, and to the first village of the Druze that they are threatened by ISIS, something like 2 kilometers. Here we can see the first home. You can see the white home.
Journalist Hamad Aiwat says the situation is desperate.
But you are getting updates from there, from different sources, that this kind of fight and this kind of threat can be in the field in the next few days or next few hours. So we are preparing ourselves now in different sites, you know, to help them and to support them.
That includes raising millions of dollars to buy weapons. They're waiting now for permission from Israel and Jordan to send those arms inside Syria. Israel has also asked the U.S. for help.
American, exactly, and all the West side must understand that the fighting of the Druze nation and the Christian, the Kurdish and the Yazidim and other is the fighting of the West side.
Ayub Kara is a Druze and also Israel's deputy minister for regional affairs. He says ISIS won't stop with the Druze.
This is a problem of the all the world, because they say in Arabic every day that they want to move to Europe, and after Europe to United States, to everywhere. They could be the third worm of the world. So we must stop it there. And how we could stop it? To supporting the Druze nation, of course, and other nations.
Aiwat says unlike other minorities in the region, like the Yazidis, the Druze know how to fight.
All of us, we are very professional with fighting. We born for fighting. We didn't born to be doctors.
The situation is so tense that the IDF declared part of the northern border a closed military zone for a day. With ISIS so close, it's possible this border area could become the next flashpoint of the Middle East. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, on the Israeli-Syrian border.
Thanks, Chris. Pat, it looks like a dire situation over there.
It does. We'll see if Chris is prophetic on that, but I think he is. It's so close. I've been there, and you look down, and you just look down, and it's Syria. I mean, here you're in the northern part of Israel, but the border is so close. And I remember that war that was I think in 73, where Israel took Quneitra and moved across. They were on the way to Damascus. But it's so easy. It's so close, and the distances are so small. And ISIS could overrun that whole situation and be at war with Israel. And suddenly you have a major conflagration. But in the meantime, the Druze, who are pretty good people, are going to be wiped out just like the Yazidis. And what's needed worse than anything is for us to help the Kurds. We've got to do something to build up those Peshmerga forces. They're the only people who want to fight. Now the Druze say, well, we know how to fight. We'll fight. Give us some weapons. But we need to wake up. And I think that the president and the people in Washington are asleep at the switch. And this thing is just deteriorating. Every single day it gets worse and worse and worse, and we're not doing much about it. John?
Pat, a New York City college student has been arrested, accused of plotting a bombing attack for ISIS. New York authorities spotted him scouting the George Washington Bridge several times. The federal government was also on to him after a message he posted on Twitter last year saying al-Qaeda was becoming too moderate. He also mentioned support for the terror attack at the Muhammad cartoon contest in Garland, Texas. Meanwhile, authorities have arrested a new suspect in that Texas terror shooting. Prosecutors have charged a Phoenix area man for helping plan that attack. He's also accused of wanting to attack the Super Bowl. Well, Donald Trump has thrown his hat into the ring for the Republican race for the White House. He made that announcement in a long, colorful speech Tuesday, blasting politicians who he says can't get things done. Recently, he told CBN's David Brody that he's not a politician, so that means he can solve America's biggest problems.
Our country is in big, big, deep trouble, and politicians are never going to get you there. They're all talk. They're no action. And I'm watching them. I mean, I'm with them a lot. And they're talking about the sun will rise and the moon will shine. And it's not what it's about. China's killing us. Mexico's killing us at the border and economically. We're losing to ISIS. I mean, we're getting killed.
You can see David's exclusive interview with Donald Trump and other GOP candidates. Just log on to cbnnews.com. And look for his blog, The Brody File. Pat, what do you think about the Donald's announcement?
Well, he's going to shake things up, and he's going to force the other guys to begin to move on certain positions that they're reluctant to do so. Because he doesn't care what he says. I mean, he's a multi-billionaire, and he's been very successful. But he's a really astute businessman. He's done a very good job. I mean, it looks like he's kind of fluff with that funny hair doing everything. But he's been extremely successful, and everything he touches seems to turn to gold. Yes, ma'am. You know,
but certainly he's going to shake things up and raise the bar. But how would somebody like Donald, the Donald who's used to calling the shots and making decisions, work with Congress?
He won't be able to, and that's why I think it'll be hard for him to win. But you're right. I mean, I worked years ago for W.R. Grace, and that was Peter Grace was the head of it, and they did something called the Grace Commission. And Peter got 2,000 outstanding top-level businessmen together, and they did an analysis of the federal government, and they came up with a brilliant plan. Guess what?
What happened?
Congress just put it in the shelf. They ignored it totally. They don't want to be told. They want nothing to take away their prerogatives. They've got their patronage. They've got their deals. And they want nobody coming in as a businessman and saying, we can do it better. Well, you can. Peter Gray showed it. Many others have showed it. And, of course, they had that commission that President Obama himself put together. And it was a brilliant analysis, and they shelved it, didn't pay any attention to it. And it was a brilliant way to solve the budget crisis. They don't care. They've got their thing. They want to stay in office. And if they have to buy votes, and if they have to raid the Treasury, they don't care. John?
Pat, the Israeli Antiquities Authority uncovered the remains of a 1,500-year-old Byzantine church just outside of Jerusalem. It was discovered as contractors widened the road from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. Archaeologists said the church was part of a larger complex that also served as a road station for pilgrims on their way to Jerusalem.
The location of the church is not accidental. On one hand, it's built beneath a water spring, which in Arabic is called Enaka, and on the other side, it's built on one of the ancient roads leading from Jerusalem, between Jerusalem and the coast. This was a road station which, besides giving services of food and drink, it also gave religious services.
The church was part of a series of churches that served travelers on their way to Jerusalem. Other churches discovered along this route include one in Emmaus, the traditional site where the New Testament says Jesus appeared to two of his disciples. Well, the Golden State Warriors are this year's NBA champions. It's their first championship in 40 years, led by Steph Curry and Andre Iguodala. The Warriors won the final three games, beating the Cleveland Cavaliers for the title last night. Iguodala was named MVP, and he, Steph Curry, and other players said they give God the glory for the team's accomplishment.
First of all, like, God is great. God is great. I want to thank all the chaplains across the NBA helping us out every single night.
I'm just so happy, man. God is great for us to be able to have this opportunity. I'm trying 1,800 more ways to explain this, because this is amazing.
Curry also told Active Faith Sports, "Each game is an opportunity to be on a great stage and be a witness for Christ. When I step on the floor, people should know who I represent, who I believe in." Pat, Golden State's longtime chaplain, told CBN News Curry and the team are the real deal. And of course, that interview with Earl Smith can be seen at cbnnews.com.
Amazing, simply amazing. And that Iguodala was named the MVP, and he sort of comes in at the last minute and saves the day over and over again. But LeBron James, he's a hero. He's the number one basketball player probably in the world or in the nation. And I would have thought the Cavaliers would win, but the Golden State took it. It was amazing, and they give glory to God. Well, I congratulate them on that victory.